Hello students, so earlier we have started about the respiratory system. Now we are dealing with chloride shift, because we know that how externally and inside internally the gaseous exchange is taking place. But what is the actual mechanism where oxygen and what happens actually inside the blood, that oxygen dissociate and carbon dioxide associate? So all this we are starting in chloride shift as well as in Bohr effect. So let's start with these two effects. So as I have told you earlier, so we are starting with that. Before that, we have to know that what is actually, so these are the very important things. So this short trick and this short formula I have made for you all to remember and to do many questions which come from this basic principle. So carbon dioxide is directly proportional to the rate of respiration as well as rate of breathing. Now what will happen? That means if carbon dioxide increases in the blood, I'm talking about in the blood, not in the environment. I'm repeating, I'm talking that carbon dioxide in the blood, if worry, then there will be changes in your respiration or in your breathing inside your body. If carbon dioxide increases in your blood, then the rate of respiration will also increase. And if carbon dioxide decrease in your blood, then the rate of respiration will also decrease. That means rate of breathing will also decrease. So our breathing is totally dependent on the concentration of carbon dioxide inside our blood. How is it possible? Let's start with here. If carbon dioxide increases, then there will be the formation of H2CO3, that is carbonic acid or bicarbonates will be forming inside our blood. I'll tell you in the next slide. And when this bicarbonates and carbonate ion will be formed, then they will split up into H positive, that is proton ion will be released. And regularly if proton ion is released, then the blood will become acidic, and that means pH decreases. If pH decreases, I'm repeating, if pH decreasing, then it will strike our respiratory center in the hind brain, and then the breathing increases. So what we have started in this slide, that if carbon dioxide increases, then breathing will also increase. And the second point, what we have started over here, that if pH decreases, then breathing increases. I'm repeating, if carbon dioxide increase, breathing increase, but if pH is decrease, then breathing is increased. That means we can say that carbon dioxide is directly proportional to the rate of breathing, but pH is inversely proportional to the rate of breathing. This is the oxygen hemoglobin dissociation curve. If you can see that on the y, on the x axis I have taken the partial pressure of the oxygen, and on the y axis I have taken the percent of saturation of hemoglobin with the oxygen. This is the normal curve where there the equilibrium state where the oxygen hemoglobin is totally saturated with the oxygen. Now what will happen? If hemoglobin is dissociate, when the oxygen is dissociate from the hemoglobin, that means oxygen is diffusing inside the cell and leaving the hemoglobin alone in the blood, then what will happen? The curve present over here will shift towards the right, while when oxygen associate with the hemoglobin in the blood from the alveoli, when the oxygen is coming from the alveoli and when it associate with the hemoglobin, at that time the curve will shift to the left. Now it is very confusing for you all how to remember that when association will takes place and when most confusing part is that when association is going on, then curve will shift right or left, and when dissociation occur, then curve will move right or left. This is the most difficult part and confusing part. So let's clear it with the short trick. Now what is the short trick? If you can see, this is I'm making R. So this R, if you making, remove this tail. If you remove the lower part of the R, then what will remaining above? D. You can see, if I'm making this R, let's making our R. Make a R. Okay. Have you make the R? Now in this R, remove this part. Now what will left to above? This structure will be left, and this is the D. That means in right dissociation, this is R, remove the lower part, upper part is D. That means in right R for right and D for dissociation of oxygen will be occur. Now it will be easy for you all. Now association, if I am talking about, if you read this, if you solve this concept and if you remember this concept, then this is more easy. What I am talking about, again I am talking that this is R, that is right, and if I remove the tail and the lower part of R, then above is remaining D structure. That means in R, that is in when curve is shifting towards the right, then dissociation will occur. And if dissociation will occur, then what will be the effect on the pH, you think? And association of hemoglobin, the curve will shift towards the left. So that means dissociation of hemoglobin is taking place. If dissociation of hemoglobin, carbon dioxide increases, if carbon dioxide is increases, that means hemoglobin, the oxygen will start dissociate. That means during dissociation of oxygen, pH will decrease, and during association of oxygen, pH will increase. I am repeating, during dissociation of oxygen, pH will decrease, and during association of oxygen, pH will increase. Remember these three basic parts. First important part is that when curve will shift to right, dissociation of oxygen will occur. When it is in the left, then association will occur. Okay. Second important thing is that during dissociation, pH will decrease, and during association, pH will increase. These are the two main important and very important part which can be framed into the question in the AIMS and in your NEET. Now talking about the Bohr effect. In Bohr effect, I have just told you what Bohr said, that he said that carbon dioxide if increases, then oxygen dissociate from the hemoglobin. And if it is so, if it has happened, then oxygen is easily removed from the hemoglobin and it is easily available to each and every cell for the respiration and for the oxidation or metabolism. And this particular effect is called Bohr effect. Now how it happens, I'll tell you in the next slide. Before that, we'll start with some important point. We know that heme means iron and globin means protein. Wherever globin is written, now it is also a basic principle of biology, that wherever globin is written, that means it is in hydrophilic protein. For example, hemoglobin, myoglobin, immunoglobin. See, so if carbon monoxide is attached with the hemoglobin, then it is called carboxyhemoglobin. When carbon dioxide is attached, then it is called carb aminohemoglobin. The difference is, now it is telling you, carb, that means carbon, amino means amino terminal of the globin protein, and hemoglobin, that means carbon dioxide is attached with the amino terminal of hemoglobin. When oxygen is attached with hemoglobin, then it is called oxyhemoglobin. So this is the Bohr effect. If you can see, so this is the cell. From the cell, you are continuously producing carbon dioxide while respiration. This carbon dioxide will enter inside the RBC. Inside our RBC, we are having water. So in the presence of carbonic anhydrase enzyme, H2CO3 will be formed. And this H2CO3 will be dissociate into proton ions, and now here proton ion will bind with the hemoglobin, so that hemoglobin do not bind with any other molecule till then. Now this the particular RBC is not permeable for the HCO3. So what will happen, there will be a mediated transportation occur inside the membrane of the RBC. What will happen, a single chloride molecule enter and mediate the transport of HCO3 outside the environment. Then what will happen, this HCO3 will again enter inside the RBC with the help of chloride ions. Then the particular proton ion, it will remove from the hemoglobin, bind with it, forming H2CO3. Again with the carbonic anhydrase enzyme, the irreversible process occur, carbon dioxide and water. Now carbon dioxide is free, and this carbon dioxide will enter inside the blood and through to the alveoli. So this is how the carbon dioxide is exhaled out from our body, from the tissue to the alveoli. So what will happen, we all are having RBCs continuously, and carbon dioxide entering in the single RBC, then it is reaching to the next RBC, and the RBC which is closer to the alveoli, from there carbon dioxide will be diffused out from the alveoli, and this is how the exhalation or the exchange of gases basically occur at the very depth level. So I hope that I have clear your many concepts and I have clear your doubt and your confusion in the Bohr effect as well as in the chloride shift. If you have any other doubt regarding this topic, then you anytime message me or comment me so that I can help you. You also ask me the question in the Quora app, that is on the Google, so that I can also help you out over there.